Yeah, we on Boss Talk 101. Yeah, we gon' talk, we gon' have fun. We be on fire, we be lit. It's a unique hustle, big shit.
Check it. It's a unique hustle. It's your boy ECO, and I'm in the building. I'm here today with the lovely, amazing, official, outstanding, creative, Miss Jamaica. What's going on?
Nothing in my day or going. I want y'all to stop what you're doing right now. Go like, subscribe, follow us on all social media platforms. When I mean all, I mean all. I mean our Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, Snapchat, you name it. We're on it. Just Google us, Boss Talk Podcast 101. We'll pop up first in line, I guarantee you. But y'all always see us on the streets and be like, man, I love what y'all doing. Keep up the good work. How can we support the brand? This is how you can support our brand. Under each and every video, including this one right here in the description section on our YouTube channel, there's a link that says join our membership. Because y'all always, man, where's this video? Where's that video? This is how you can see all our exclusive content is by being a member today. Thank me later, and we love you, and thank you for all the love and support.
Man, check it, man. Hey, man, listen, man. We got a special guest for you guys today, man. She don't need no introduction, man. Listen, man. I'm talking about she in the building, man. Y'all about to be blown away by her story. Miss Katina Prescott's in the building, y'all. Stand up for Miss Katina Prescott.
Hey, y'all. How y'all doing?
How you doing?
I'm doing good.
Man, hold up, man. So, hey, man, listen. You from Milwaukee?
Yes, I am. Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Born and raised.
Milwaukee.
Milwaukee raised, Texas paid. That's what I'm saying.
Oh, man. When you was up in Milwaukee, did you ever come across to Chicago? It ain't but about an hour.
Absolutely. Hop on the highway like it's nothing.
Already.
That's where you go party. That's where you go party and you going back home. Yeah.
So Milwaukee didn't have no good parties down there?
Oh, we had some good parties, but you know, Chi-Town had a variety. So yeah, so we would get on the highway and be there in no minute. St. Louis was another spot we ride out to, but we had to spend the night there.
What's Milwaukee known for? Other than what is it, pimping and hoes?
What?
I'm just saying.
Shout out to Pimpin' Kim, my nigga from Milwaukee. Stop playing.
When people find out I'm from Milwaukee, when I'm here, they be like, I ain't know black people was in Milwaukee.
I'd say that. That's
and
me.
I'm like, it's a lot of us. It's
because it be cold. Mainly.
But we love it. You know, get your little jacket on, your little boots and stuff. And we still get out there.
Ain't y'all
no
be dressing.
Dressing it. Minks. You know, Pimpin' Kid, we get it all. We have it all. So I actually gave mine away when I
was about to say, you had a mix?
When I realized I had a blue one, a brown one, and a black rabbit mix.
Wow.
Yeah. Stop playing, man. That black rabbit mix. Don't bring that over
chinchilla,
here.
Chinchilla, for sure.
Let's get to it, baby.
So were you raised with your mom and dad in the same household growing up?
I was not. My mom raised me single mom, but I did have a very close relationship with my dad.
Really? Oh, yeah. So he was also from Wisconsin?
Yes, born and raised. Okay. Wisconsin.
So mm-hmm. You used to go visit him?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
Did he remarry?
He never remarried. No. Okay. No. And unfortunately, both of my parents are deceased. My dad passed in 2013, and my mom just recently, this past January.
Wow.
So
I did
have. Yeah, pancreatic cancer. I hate it.
Lost mine, too. Yeah. Lost both of them, so I definitely can relate. I lost my dad in 2012. My mom way back in 96.
They were young. 19.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So, but at the end of the day, we still here to be an example.
Absolutely.
For our, you know, God had not left us here, put us here on this earth in order for us not to carry on.
That's
he
it.
Say, be fruftful and multiply.
Okay.
So at the end of the day, they did the multiplying and now I'm dividing and conquering. You know what I'm
saying? Okay. All right. Sound like you're from Milwaukee. That's a little lie.
No, definitely, man. Just happy to have you on the show.
So, were you an only child or
no? I have four other sisters, so it was all girls.
All girls. Where did you fall?
Yes.
Oh,
I am the oldest.
Man.
You're the oldest.
I am the oldest.
Ooh,
yes.
Eva. Ooh, you remember Deliver Us From Evil? That's all right there.
Wow.
Oh my God, you running all you with that movie.
Oh,
you
see remember how she looks?
Deliver Us From Evil, man. Deliver Us From Katina, man.
You try
man.
To control all good. Your.
You try to control them, didn't
like
you?
They couldn't date this guy. You can't talk to this
honestly,
guy.
No, it was actually quite the opposite. I was very protective of my sisters. So.
That's what Deliver Us From Evil was too.
So it, you know, it's not like you can't go date him or whatever. He'd be, you know, in Milwaukee, you let him know right out the gate, she ain't the one. Go around the corner. Not that one, sir.
And you had to lead by example.
that was my responsibility. But you know, as young, you do things, so you try to cover it up so they don't get it. But they ended up finding their way too, and I would say that they're all proud of me as I am of them, or what we've come to be considering where we come from.
Tell me a time when you were younger where you fell, and you had to find your way. How did you find your way, and how did you overcome? And how old were you when this happened?
Getting pregnant as a teen.
How old were you?
I was 17. I did walk across the stage, high school with a graduate, with a belly. Mm. And the hardest part was feeling a disappointment with my mom. My mom was a teen mom. She had me at 15, well, birthed me at 16. Mm. So she wanted different for me. And I always felt that I disappointed her in that way. And then that was a period in my life where we weren't seeing eye to eye. Because I think her disappointment, she reflected it kind of like as anger. Then I thought I wasn't good enough, you know. And me and my sisters had different fathers. So I was the only one who had a different father. So then in my mind, I'm thinking, you treating me different. It was just, you know, let's say this, I left home very early. Mm-hmm. And I had to learn a lot by trial and error, being misled, getting into things that I shouldn't have got into. But survival skills kick in. Mm-hmm. They kick in. And my grandmother, my dad's mother, Nadine Hunt, was the one who told me, you're going to school. And when she pushed me to go to school, to college, she said, you're going to raise this baby, but I'll watch him while you go to school. So I would get on the bus.
So you had support.
I had that. It was support, but she didn't let me. I didn't get to go kicking and all that. I'm going to school and coming back. Mm-hmm. And she really taught me the importance of being a mom, getting an education. She wanted different for her grandkids. So we did that, and things worked out. And I won't lie, once I got engaged in a different environment with people who had more, saw different, I learned about a lot. Importance of retirement, how important your credit is. You know, I'm rubbing elbows with people, what they call traditional students, mm-hmm. but I was a little bit older. But I learned a lot and made good friends, so I pushed that all the way through to get a double master's degree.
Wow. Oh, well, let's not go there. No. Double master's degree. You got more degrees than a thermometer. Hold on. I want to ask you about the fact of this baby daddy. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Where was he at in this child's life, and if he was or if he wasn't?
Partially. How old was he?
He was 2 years old. Okay. He was 2 years older.
So he was 19. 19.
He was 19. Yeah. He was 19. Okay. And then he went to the military.
Okay.
So him going to the military provided certain benefits for me.
He was on child support.
No, at that time I didn't push for that because we had a good relationship and his mom didn't play at all. So she made sure that he was a responsible father. The only part I will say that I regret is that the fact he didn't spend a lot of time with the upbringing of my son, but my son didn't want for nothing. And then when he got out of the military, he worked for GE. So being a single mom at a teen was difficult, but thankfully finances and things like that, it wasn't too bad. And for me personally, like I said, I thought being a teen and it was a disappointment to family members and things of that nature. I felt like being the black sheep. Mm-hmm. And some of the things that I heard, like, you're going to always be on welfare, you're going to do this, that. And I tell you right now, and this is the God honest truth, ain't none of my kids been birthed off of welfare. I worked. Mm-hmm. I hustled. I did what I had to do. Not a one. Now, I might have got some Quest food stamps or something from somebody, but
yeah, you bought some of them old food stamps. I bought some too, but
you know, the paper, the
we buy some every now and then. But I just want to say, like, when you guys basically, you being young as you were, him as well, you know, both of y'all had to do things in order to sacrifice for the child. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's a blessing that y'all got it done. What did he did play part in his son's
life? Yes, he did.
Right?
He did. When the time permitted. He absolutely was there.
That's
and
great.
They have a good relationship.
People need to hear
day.
That. People need absolutely. To hear that because a lot of people don't have that story.
Right.
I want to get that part out there that he just because something might not go the way we planned it, it can be okay.
Absolutely.
And you're the epitome of that, especially with your 300 degrees. You know what I'm saying?
And I think that's the thing, too, the stereotypes of, like, where you at, was you a single parent? You know, where did you live? Or, you know, this person on the block, they expect for that to be your outcome.
Yeah.
And I just never wanted to be that. So I did things and got with people who knew things to teach me outside of my normal community. And then I bring that knowledge back and be like, hey, you know you can buy, you know what stock is, you know what a mutual fund is, you mm-hmm. know, you know, that kind of thing. And it went from there.
You know, I always believe that nothing happens by a mistake. Everything happens for a reason.
Absolutely.
But at the same time, we as human beings always trying to figure out, okay, where did this person go wrong? Mm-hmm. Where did we, you know, so others can learn from it so they don't go down that path at mm-hmm. the same time. And hearing your story to that point, I'm like, okay, do you feel like you would have not gotten pregnant if your father was living in the same household and present in your life to that aspect?
In all honesty, I'm going to say no.
Okay.
Because even though I was at a young age, I still knew right from wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we go through our adolescence of thinking, and he was a well-known basketball star. He was cute. We were in a project, you know, so it was like he was that person. Mm-hmm. So as we grow in kids and teenage years, you find out who you like, think you're going to be with that person forever. Whether my father was in the household, if that would have changed, I honestly won't put that on him and say probably so, because at the end of the day, I made the decision.
Yeah, because your mom did talk to you about all
absolutely.
Of that. You know,
not in some details, like I talked to my daughter when
right.
she was coming up,
it's
but
a
it was like,
age.
It ain't finna happen. You
right.
know, it was different.
It's different.
So it was like a fear, like you do this, you know, the watermelon, you push it through that. It was that kind of scare. Like,
wow.
That's what happened. And then when
okay.
you get with your peers and find out,
that's
that ain't
not
really,
really
what happened. Oh, it's, you know, then you peep game and you start exploring things.
Mm-hmm. yeah. All I can say is, man, yeah, I bet you were down there, all four of y'all sisters, exploring the hell out of things. I don't trust you. I know how it is when you sisters and y'all, you know, yeah, you had a was you the toughest one, or was it, which one of y'all was the toughest one? Let's be real. Let's put it out here. Was it you or was it who?
I would say it was me first and then my sister right up under me.
Yeah, y'all was the
Peaches.
One brought the pain. Well, yeah, mama, word the hell out of mama. Mama trying to figure out what's going on. She
got that gray hair early because of y'all.
I don't know what time they're getting back, girl. I know they left. They said they were coming right back.
So that was a no because she did not play.
Y'all
so
didn't even get to go nowhere?
My mom was a black belt in karate.
Oh,
so
she
was very strict, very, you know, and she worked
she
and was trying to go to school.
You ever see her get out there?
And I did.
Nah.
Yes, I did.
Who she put
yes,
it on? Who she put
when?
It on?
Like, at the time, somebody talking crazy to one of the
she
girls.
She dropped kick one?
She don't, she, my daddy.
that's probably why
you
he left.
You know she ain't playing.
He left. I don't want to fight her all the time. She want to fight every
and she
evening.
She going to win too.
Oh yeah, she ended up with a belt on when he come home.
No,
looking.
My mom was a very strong woman. I think that was her upbringing too. Very strong. Because her own personal childhood things, she had to kind of stand in that place. And I think some of that did rub off on me and my sister mm-hmm. underneath me.
Because you know how they always say, what's it say, generational curse or whatever, it can pass down. But a lot of times we don't know what our parents go through until we get older and sit them down and have that discussion. And sometimes kids, I hear them say, you know, they carry resentment and hate because of the way how a parent might act,
mm-hmm.
but not understanding why they do and why
absolutely.
They say certain things till later on. And be like, oh, but she went through. But that's why this generation I like better
mm-hmm.
for the main fact that we're more vocal.
Vocal.
So we explain
absolutely.
More to our kids.
Absolutely.
You know?
And that is the truth because, like I said, my mom passed this past January,
mm-hmm.
and that's exactly my story. Because when I got pregnant, I felt we bumped heads a lot. She didn't like me. Why she treat me this way? And then was smart enough to say, and you had me at 6, you know, all that.
Yeah.
And it was a pop, 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 pop.
Yeah,
she got with you. Oh, my mama got with
of
me.
Of course.
But she kind of taught me, too. Because, you know, when you fight and get, you know, you learn, but yeah, you learn some stuff.
Me,
but that was definitely, that was my story.
You wearing this shirt. It says beautifully bald.
Yes, sir.
It's
alopecia month now.
September, yes.
Oh, was it September?
It was September.
Yes. Oh,
September.
Uh-huh. Well, we're now.
Well, I want to just let's talk about this because we see these girls on this shirt
looking
I'm
beautiful.
Thinking, well, no, I'm thinking I'm watching Wakanda. Black Panther.
That's
I didn't know if you were gonna hit the damn stick when you got in there or what. You know,
I'm doing the following.
I ain't want no problem.
I
just knew it was gonna be some stuff. I said, well, here she come with her clan. Nah, her and my wife, you're going to take my wife and be over for me in a minute. Well, so let's talk about it.
Well, with my story, and what I just shared with mm-hmm. you as I got older, building a new relationship with my mom as an adult. My mom then really praised me as the type of mother I was, the type of education. All my kids except one, college degrees. My son's truck, they all got good, like everybody doing well. And we have that very open communication. Right. I wanted a little different than what it was for me. And through that, I just started kind of like ministering and cultivating people who wanted to know why, what happened, how did you do this, you know, considering those who knew me. And so I just started to be a life coach. So I'm a master life coach.
That's all.
And this movement is about empowering. So the organization is called She Is Movement. She is an acronym for Strong, Healed, and Empowered.
Okay.
So we have programs and services for women who are going through, because I believe just because of your circumstances, it does not define what your outcome has to be. I'm a prime example. Being a teen mom, going through a lot, I'm talking about, and I'm just going to keep it very transparent, sexual assault.
At how old?
I think I was between about maybe 7, 8, 9 oh, that I can recall.
By who?
A family member.
When he said sexual assault, molestation or rape?
Molestation. Yes. Okay. I call it sexual assault because that's just what it is.
Right. It's the overall. Right.
Absolutely. So.
Did you tell your mom?
When I was an adult.
Oh, so when you were younger.
The person I did tell didn't believe me, and it was, you fat, sit down somewhere, you know, it was me.
That was your auntie?
No.
Or grandma.
Auntie, yeah.
And I figured.
The other grandmother. So, okay. And I love her to death, but I also think that, too, had trauma before, too. So, like you said, as I got older, I started trying to figure out, why am I reactive this way? You know, somebody says, what? You know, because I'm trying to protect myself as I couldn't then. And then a friend in school that became a very good friend of mine introduced me to the benefits of therapy. And that was the best gift she could have ever gave me.
How old were you at that time?
Probably like 33, 34.
Oh, so, okay. So you were in college.
I was older. Yeah.
Okay.
Still meeting people. And, okay. You know, I built relationships. And like I said, they shared things and exposed me to different things. So I started to want to take that journey of the why me, and then learning things. And I just didn't want to take that step to talk to my mom about it, because I knew she hadn't had the support and services, so I didn't want to bring up any past trauma for her, you know. So I kind of suppressed that, but I worked on myself. And as I got through that, you couldn't tell me nothing. You know, I'm an entrepreneur. I headed a corporation workforce development, and I was over a contract, $64 million. I had 172 staff under me, and everything from master life coach. I make sure I indulge myself in things that I can learn and then tell my friends, tell
but
my
can
children,
that make
tell
you
my
too because I've heard so many women who dive into self-improvement so much, and this strength, I'm a woman, I'm mm-hmm. strong, I'm this, you can't tell me nothing. Can that make you too strong where when it comes to males, you can actually cower down a man sometimes by doing that?
Absolutely.
And not actually having this man be a man because, oh, I don't need you, I don't, mm-hmm. type of thing.
Mm-hmm. I think for me, it wasn't so much of a I don't need. I took on the role where I positioned him.
Right.
You know, I need you to, hey, we can do this, da-da-da, get on this, you take care of this. I did that, and it actually, how I used to say is, instead of them learning to appreciate, they started taking advantage of that because I was the brains, and I ain't scared to say it. I was the brains, and the ones that I still have a good relationship with will tell you, because when we still talk, they say, you should have been my wife, you do. But we were all young and learning things. I just learned and took action. I really did something different. And what it did was, it had me so ingrained on making the money. You know, I got life insurance now, I got stocks and this and that. I'm teaching my kids this. I bought the house, built it from the ground up, did it by myself. I'm thinking I'm on top, but I was not living in my true purpose. And that's how this came in, the full movement, because I am a servant leader. I like helping people, and I wanted to position myself where this movement became something of empowering women.
You were one of those people that, you know, I often, you know, I look at, you know, and I really feel like men a lot of times, are you married?
No, I am not.
I feel like men, you know, it's hard for a man to come into your life and really try, you know, figure out a way to, not me. Now, mm-hmm, I'm mm-hmm. just so happen to be married, but I could handle anything. I just mean, it's a difference, you know what I'm uh-huh. saying? Because you got to be prayed up. A lot of men aren't on a level to handle Absolutely. That. I am that guy
okay.
from Genesis to Revelation. So, oh, you know, okay. when I walk in the room, you will do. That's why she uh-huh. likes shields. Uh-huh. Like, you didn't know that, but you will know messing with. Yeah. It's a whole, Okamo, no. Just go on, just be real.
Uh-huh.
I it's something different about that one. You can't, uh-huh. God going to show it, and you're going to be like, yeah, whatever
yeah.
you say.
Yeah.
I'm going to do, you know. But you got to be strong. You know what I mean?
And I
get it. But, you know, I understand that you've been through a lot, too. And that therapy that you went through, how do you deal with today? Are you ever going to get married?
So.
Do you ever want to get married?
I always did. And let's I actually talk about was in a situation where I was literally that close.
You was how close?
Like this close.
That's real close.
How long was the relationship?
3.5 years.
Okay. That's close for you. And that's a big breakthrough for you.
No, I actually do well.
No.
The tolerance level, let me say that. For me, like, I can take so much, but I ain't the one that it could just keep happening over and over and over and over. And I think what helps me be able to make that move is because I empowered myself. Like, I didn't have to, I had my own money, I had my own car, I had my own house. Okay, we're gonna work this out, but you keep playing in my face, I'm not gonna stick around. And it's not like I gotta think about it, like, okay, where I'm gonna go, what I'm gonna do. I had my own. So it was an easier exit for me, but I didn't exit right away. I always gave the benefit of the doubt, but you're not going to play in my face.
How long ago was this?
Now, see, this is crazy. My mom passed January, this past January. My engagement broke. We broke that off. Well, I broke it off. February 17th.
Yeah, now, wait a minute. Now, let me just say this before we go in front. let me say this. You know, mm-hmm. and I know mm-hmm. you go to that therapist and they sit there and they talk to you. And one of the things I'm pretty sure they told you mm-hmm. is that you don't make big decisions when you're going through a depressive time.
Yes.
Did they tell you that? Now I want to know, Katina.
That is factual. That is true.
I
want to
know.
So calm down. But I had already did it.
No, you don't get over like that.
Or you would have did it too. Because
what happened in this relationship?
She was already married.
Whoa. Huh? See, now, wait a minute. Let me back up.
To you.
Wait a minute.
Baby had the ring on the finger. We all over Instagram, Facebook, everywhere.
Let me just be real with you. He was already married. Uh-huh. You didn't see a sign of that.
Never.
No.
Hold on.
And y'all lived in the same house.
Exactly. Hold on. She was in another state, though.
No, but he was sleeping in your bed. Hold on. He was sleeping in your bed every single night. Sunday through Saturday.
We lived in the same house. I Airbnb'd my home that I bought out because I was always there.
For the whole 3 years?
Because the first year, you know, I'm still kind of so. But
was he a truck driver? Decision,
no, he wasn't. He's in IT. No joke.
But first of all, let me stop. You messed the man of you up. I want to apologize.
Yes, because I wasn't supposed to stick around.
No, I want to apologize for men, you know, on the behalf of men for mm-hmm. you going through that. I really do, because that is crazy. Mm-hmm. You know, quite interesting, though, because how do you run a check? Have you run background checks on people?
So you're
really smart. Like, you got 300 degrees. You have more degrees than a thermometer. You
know, I did not run a background check, but I took my time into getting into the relationship.
You need to run a background check.
Yes. This came up for taxes. He had some tax issues, and I'm thinking, oh, we finna be one. So I have a friend that was, and I was like, I need you to do a tax audit.
That's how you found out.
That's how sometimes he's filed married sometimes. So then when I brought it up, I could see the look on his face, and then it was wop right after
what
that.
What do you mean wop?
I was so mad, I lost it.
You whooped
it.
The nigga?
I didn't whoop.
You what? I'm trying to figure out.
You know, little Bob.
You said wop, 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 wop.
That's the mother in you came out. Your mama.
I'm telling you, because I was so hurt because I finally was able, what I thought, to let
is
my
that
guard down.
Is
being
it?
My, that's what my ex said. He's like, I know he got a Mr. Potato Head. I know he got a lump or something because you hit my eye that time.
Oh, man. I see what's going on.
That's a joke.
No, but y'all no, abusive.
But it did.
All
my
four
feelings
y'all.
Was hurt.
He's all like, four y'all abusive. Y'all be fighting.
That's sad. Mama was a black belt. It didn't came out on both of
them. Yeah, I mean, she was.
Yeah, and all y'all probably got belts yourself. I get it. But I'm sorry for that because I didn't see that one coming. But You got to do a little better. Now that's God telling you need to do background checks.
Yeah, I can do some back. Right, yeah, now
we'll do
just,
that next time.
I don't
time.
Even want to.
If you with, you got a boyfriend now.
Yeah. It's a few that.
Did you run the background
not
check?
Not boyfriend.
My homeboy police. We can run it through the system.
Okay,
you get his license number.
I'm gonna get that. I'm gonna get that.
I'm trying to figure out how not to let that happen again.
Yeah. No, that ain't gonna be. Yeah. So whole another state. She was. I guess they had already been.
Did you talk
whatever.
To her?
I didn't. No.
What for?
No. That's why I was like, what? Because there was, for me, from my understanding, there was no, like, it had already been broken. She was doing her thing, but they never really got formal separation, paper form, or divorce. So my thing was.
But he didn't tell you.
You didn't tell me.
Right.
And therefore, you're an, I can't trust you.
Right.
And from my history and things I've been through, if the trust is broken, it's going to be very hard. I'm not going to be going through nobody's phone. I'm not doing that. I need to sleep peacefully, whether you beside me or not. I need to know you come. All the other, I can't do that.
You're gonna
and
have
so
to,
that's
did you write a letter out? Your therapist tell you to write a letter and just say, hey, everything, get in, throw it away and burn it. I mean, did you do some things to push this? Because we got to move on.
I'm still actually healing right now.
That's what I know. I can.
I really,
that's what I'm telling you.
I really am. So.
We got to get that out.
I'm scared at this point. I don't know what's out there. Wow. So
because looking back, did you? You know, sometimes in hindsight, looking back, you'd be like, okay, I did see this red flag.
I promise you. I promise you.
There was none.
If you can call anybody where you saw him, you saw me. We both worked from home at that time because from COVID, we both were allowed to work from home. So, like,
pictures everywhere.
Pictures everywhere. And he
yeah,
wasn't on social media.
He wasn't with her.
He wasn't with her.
He was with me. No, that's what
right.
I'm saying.
So she would have no reason to even see the picture and then, oh, let me contact her to let her know X, Y, Z.
Have he tried to contact you again?
Let me tell you this. He's Kenyan. And I told him, if you call me again, I will be calling the U.S. Embassy. Because you legal, but your sister not. Stop
That's
calling
crazy
me.
Crazy, because you the one I ain't got you a
Stop
whole damn
calling
Africa.
Me.
You know, I didn't even know. Now you done hit me with a real one. Like, you done went all across and you out
men
there.
Are
you
men.
Really is Wakanda. You is. You really is. I know already. I already know. This is real. I knew it.
It is real, but.
But I hate that you went through that because at the end of the day, you know, relationships are tough.
That was the last
you know?
Thing that I said I was going to give it a shot. I mean, he literally said, hey, because I was what I call multi dating. I had one, like, physical partner, but, you know, I just kept it open because I was new to Texas. And I, you know, I'm just like, I don't know. And he was one that said, you know, I really think we should like, and I'm like, okay, well, give me a little bit because I got to make sure, because if I'm going in, I'm going in right. And then you got your time to do whatever, get your situation straight, because if it don't be right, it ain't right.
I'm going to be honest. Can I be honest with you? You know, my mind is going all kind of places
what?
Right now. I mean, you know, them Africans be scamming. I got scammed by one before I met Oki. And I'm going to be real with you. My tax came to my house and I seen I had made a lot more money than what I had gotten. And she was an African woman, so I'm just going to be honest with you. Just be careful when you go over dealing with that. God bless y'all. I know already OG Piru came on and outed y'all.
Uh-oh.
But I'm just saying a lot of my African friends have been scammers.
Mm.
So just be careful. You got to check everything when you start rolling.
Going forward. I think I'm just going to chill date. Like, people in this one guy really.
The
like,
African?
No, he's not. He's not. He's actually from my hometown, but he's here now. And, you know, we talk and hang out, but I'm not at that. Like,
that
I tell Okamar all
you
the time.
You haven't forgiven that guy.
Like, I don't even want to step into it because you pay a lot of money.
Well, baby, you just left this dude.
That's what
home.
I'm saying. And I made that very
chill,
clear
just
to him.
Tell
just
him
to say,
hey,
I'm in my... You can
let him know.
He's
in
your
zone. If you're going to be there, nigga. You know, I'm talking about we got a lot of healing to do.
Right.
We got to forgive this one.
Right.
Get this out. The letter ain't even wrote yet. And you already trying to... We trying to write this letter out to try to forgive this man.
You try to move quick, yeah. So I ain't even there in the mental space. I am very much focused on my nonprofit organization providing services. Like, I feel like everything that happened allowed me to have now the time, space, and focus to dive deep into my nonprofit with the bald pageant, with the She Is movement. My focus is truly there. And
I got to ask this. Just stop it.
Excuse you.
See?
Excuse you.
See, get it together. Exactly. When you come over here,
exactly. Let me ask you. Yes, because growing up, okay, every time when I would normally see a woman or a man, well, not male, but mainly woman with a bald head, mm-hmm. the first thing people think about, oh, she has cancer. Mm-hmm. But now, I'm going to always say it's because of Jada Pinkett, when she was talking about her alopecia and stuff like mm-hmm. that. All of a sudden, now you see a lot more women are bold enough to come out and wear the bald head and not try to cover it up with a
wig. That's what I was going to talk about.
And so forth. So, when did you start this journey and what caused your journey of...
So alopecia, I have mm-hmm. a rare immune deficiency, which causes my red blood cell count to be extremely, extremely low, where it impacts everything from my skin, my fingernails, my hair.
Really?
And I wore weaves and stuff a lot. And so they used to say, oh, that it's because it's too tight or whatever. And then when I found out what it was, I was depressed. I just did the big chop myself, cried it out. Then my son came and really got
How
me
long
together.
Ago was that?
I've been 7 years now.
Seven years.
And for me, in my hometown, because I was always extreme, whether it was the clothes, the hair, I've had colored hair, long hair, braids, or whatever. So when they saw it, it wasn't like, what happened? It was like, this bitch. It was like that. It really was. So it actually, even though I was scared.
Yeah, I was about to say.
It made me be like, and I am. And I just been just.
Wow. Because it takes a lot of guts.
A little bit, bit different. But I do get exactly what you said. People come in and try to do the pity thing like that. And like, then when they learn that it's, I told them it's by choice because I could put on a wig or something. Then I see. At the time, because I also sold jewelry at Macy's, right? So the white women, they come be like, oh my God, I wish I had the, I wish I could, you know, this, that. Or they'll be like, Queen, or, you know, Queen, you look beautiful. I wish I could. My husband don't even know. I'm like, well, when your time come, you know, you'll know.
It takes a lot of guts.
If that's what you want to do, you know. Mm-hmm. So I'm never pressuring anybody to do it. It's all about in here.
Let's go back to when your son, that day, when you were going through the depressive states mm-hmm. of having to know that you was going to have to be walking around not having hair when mm-hmm. you used to having hair.
Mm-hmm.
How tough was that during those times? I want to talk about that.
It was tough. So any woman could tell you, and probably any man too, if you waking up or you washing your hair and you got gobs of hair or you notice a bald spot and it grows and grows and grows, it will do something to you mentally. It will, because there's society norms, right?
How long were you struggling with it?
So I always, so in my family, like the edges were always thin. My sisters, my aunts and all of that. So really that's what I'm like, oh, I just heard, you know, whatever. Right. But as I got older and I always rocked a weave, a wig, a sew-in or whatever, and I used to notice when they get the braids taken out, it would be so much hair. So much hair. And I'm just like, okay. The stylist would be like, oh, that's dead hair because you know.
Right, that's what we always hear as females.
Baby. No.
So it's not normal.
I mean, not that. It was a lot of hair. And that's what we are taught. Well, it's been up for a month, two months. When you take it down, it'd be a whole bunch of hair. You're not letting those follicles get clean, for one, mm-hmm. the moisture, the oxygen, and then, you know, African Americans, we have low vitamin D is one thing, vitamin iron. So that's my situation. My iron was so low, and even back in the day with my son, the one I told you I was pregnant with, they'd say, oh, you got low iron, take some, you get your week check, take, go get some pills. No, like I was this just really just what, wow. 2-3 weeks ago, he said, you either get these injections or you're going to have to come on in here and get this blood transfusion.
Wow.
That's how low.
That's how
so
low.
So I have to see a hemoglobin specialist, all of that. And then we start identifying the different things that your blood is important for your body to work. My kidneys, you know, like everything could be impacted by blood.
How did it affect your cycle?
Girl, if I sneeze, I used to tell a joke, if I sneeze, it's a murder scene.
That's why that nigga left.
You crazy.
I should have told you that. That nigga gone. He is tired of this.
I would figure if you that low in iron, I'm talking about that.
No, I'm just kidding.
It was bad. 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 It's our conversation today.
Well,
yeah.
One thing about it, though, you know, you're a strong woman to go through all the stuff that you, you know, you had to deal with. all jokes to the side, it's a blessing that you would be able to come into these younger girls' lives or people who just having to deal with that experience and show them how to make it through. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? We don't go through something for nothing.
Right.
God got you going for every single bit of this for a reason.
And I truly so believe that.
So even when you had to do the karate on the nigga, all the that, you know what I'm saying, is your testimony.
Absolutely.
Pretty much absolutely. Working up to where you can help somebody else who have to karate chop a nigga. You know what I'm saying?
How long did it take you? Because I know you said you put on that front of, you know, being a brave person and mm-hmm. whatever, but inside you were still, you know, self-conscious and, you know, scared. Mm-hmm. How long did that go for before you were like, okay, I'm just, screw it?
Actually, for me personally, not long because of my environment. Mm-hmm. In Milwaukee, it's very small, so all the clubs, you're going to see everybody. Mm-hmm. So, they were used to me. It wasn't like, girl, what? It was more or less, you done did something. Well, tomorrow, you know, and then I started slowly sharing with my aunts and stuff what it was, so my family knew. But going out, I always had so people in the area, it was just like, oh, she'll be doing something else later. And then once I started sharing it with people, it was like, you didn't, you know, like, why you didn't say nothing? Like, damn, I'm just finna say. I just was really concerned how people would accept me. I ain't gonna even lie, I was concerned about the dating scene.
That's what I was wondering.
Which actually elevated me. It was stupid when I got here.
Really? They love the bald head.
Oh, sorry.
Especially them Africans. Them Africans is only.
And the Hispanics.
And the Hispanics.
What is the craziest pickup line come to you because of the bald head? Or you don't even get that?
It's not even, it's just like a norm. I think it's just, so a couple guys would say things like, you know, it's the confidence. It's just your natural beauty. Like, there's nothing swoop you can hide behind. There's no, it's just, and then how you wear it. So when I walk into the room or when I go somewhere, I don't walk in feeling like, oh, I'm a bald woman. I go in fly as I want to be, and that's just it. And you're going to connect with people who you vibe with.
Right.
And I just, like I said, right now, if I wanted to, I probably could be like, okay, we can go out on a date. I drove, went the weekend, had a good time. Then I didn't want to talk to him after.
Yeah, you used him. Look, man, I'm not going to sit here and sugarcoat nothing over here on this side. You used him and then you left him. But it's cool. Well, why did you go with him in the first place?
Because I thought I was.
Like I said, I'm not going to do this with y'all, man. I don't like all that.
And do you notice that they're, like, you know how sometimes it's so weird that before you do something, you don't notice everybody else have it, but mm-hmm. all of a sudden you do it, it's like all of a sudden you see other people popping up. You're like, oh, I didn't even notice.
Exactly.
Do you That's see
exactly
a lot of people happened. Popping up, a Absolutely. Lot of people approaching you, females who be like, you know, I also did
yes.
it. And
yes. So we had the first Bald and Beautiful pageant mm-hmm. September 28th. Uh-huh. And
how many people turned up?
So we sold 332 tickets. And we had 25 contestants. But when I first announced this, and again, this was something that I had wrote down, I just was so busy doing everything else that I never got the time to focus and make it happen mm-hmm. until my mom went through the hospice piece. And, you know, they kind of get delusional a little bit. And she used to say, where your dress at? You're going to be on TV. But sometimes not even to me saying it to, but it, and then when I had my original meltdown when I got back from Milwaukee, something said, go get your notebook where you wrote about the pageant. And I promise you, we buried my mom on January 17th. I announced the pageant the day after that was over. So that was February 18th. And then we had it on the 20th. I didn't have a place. I didn't know how I was going to do it. But I know it was something I wanted my mom to be proud of me wow. about. So that's why we did it. And I kind of built it as we went. What I did not expect is the amount of people that wanted to be, I'm talking about people calling me, crying, some of the contestants to say, I felt like a princess when I tried on my dress. This is a lifetime experience. Oh, thank you. I didn't know that it was gonna be that type of impact. We have a waiting list of 213 women right now waiting for the next casting call for 2025. Wow. And we're gonna do a tour where we're gonna pick five states to go and do our casting call, because I had to do everything virtually. I had nothing planned. I just stood
and people flew in
from New York, Maryland, California, Pennsylvania, Alabama, Georgia. You know, they had the hurricane, right? Mm-hmm. We had one contestant. She drove.
Wow.
You advertised this on social media. That's how you got it out there?
And not even really. It was like, once I said it, I promise you, I woke up the next morning. I was like, y'all see a little 800 some followers. That happened overnight because of this movement right here.
Oh, it's going to get bigger now.
And it's
going to
get, people are contacting us about the pitch for like a TV show.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's
going to grow. I'm telling you, because, you know, ever since Will Smith
slapped,
we've been looking for this movie. We have been waiting on this movement ever since.
You have Jada come in and speak.
Christian said what he said. But the movement is on now, Chris, and Will, you know, he did what he did because of his wife and her situation. And it's people like you who are stepping up and saying, you know, no more.
Yeah.
But saying? I love it.
I love it. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is dope. You know what I'm saying? I didn't see it coming. Mm-hmm. Have y'all heard from Jada?
No, so I did not reach out to Jada.
Well, she'll hear about it from here.
Please, hit me up, Jada.
I'm a tagger. Since she want to play. And shout out to my boy, Kenyatta Sands, who knew her too. We're going to tag her on this. You need to get with the program.
But I did not know, because you just educated me on it. I didn't know that that's how alopecia, with the red blood cells and all of that.
I didn't know that either.
Well, that's just one. Alopecia, the word means hair loss.
Right. But
there's different medical reasons. Mine's happened to be an immune deficiency.
Oh.
Other women have other things, and it's different types of it.
Right.
That's just my
Because I had
story.
A friend of mine who went to high school when I was in high school. She was in a different high school. And because of stress, she sit down
stress
and pulled her hair out just out of stress. And so she would have bald patches and it wouldn't grow back.
That's alopecia.
And she would try to hide it and stuff like that. Wow. But they just didn't have a name for it back then. It was just hair loss.
Man, you guys, y'all tripping me out. Like I said, I didn't know nothing about it. You know, Jada was the first one that I
Me too, really.
I didn't know nothing about it.
It's
I thought
a whole community
it
was,
and then
there.
They started making jokes saying Pac had it, you know, all kind of stuff, and being real.
Men do
and
have
and
it.
And I
though,
was like, really? She said that Pac had alopecia too. And I'm like, well, hell, I thought he
But men get away
spot.
With a bald head and it's like it's nothing.
And remember, alopecia, if you look it up, it's just, the word means hair loss.
Yeah.
So it's just the different forms of it. And like you said, with men, with bald, but some women get that hereditary from their fathers too.
Cut it.
That's alopecia. It's alopecia.
So men who you know how the men here recede and they have the bald patch. Is that alopecia?
It's just hair loss.
It's hair loss.
Yeah, they never thought about it.
But the thing is, man, you basically done figured it all out. Then with all them degrees you got, I could see this happening. You know what I'm saying? In a mighty way.
It's a movement.
Yeah.
For sure.
So I mean, so when is the next one? Is when?
So we are going to be setting a date for September the 13th. The 13th, Saturday the 13th, but this time...
2025.
We've learned a few things to make it better for next year, so we may have it a Friday, Saturday, so we want to have more women be able to compete, and when I get a chance to get the footage, I will share with you. When I say these sisters bad to the bone.
Yes.
I'm talking about bad. The swimsuit threw me off. I said, what? Okay, all right.
Y'all had
because
a swimsuit.
So we had the categories. So they had the we had our initial act, opening act. We had the swimsuit category, talent, what I call my prerogative, jazz it up how you feel, show us, let us see your personality. We had the formal wear with the long, beautiful gowns, and then we had their interview questions. And their questions were anything that was kind of personal. Tell us your why. Give us an experience. What would you share with a woman who's hiding that she's bald on her wig, who wants to be free, but she's afraid of what her husband might feel or do? So it was very touching, but it was just great.
What's the most touching story you heard that night?
So one of the questions, well, I should say one of the individuals that I met was the father of a young lady. Her name is, I want to say Angel, but it's not. Oh, she's going to kill me. But unfortunately, Angel was a 12-year-old girl who was being bullied at school. She had alopecia. Angel took her life.
Wow.
She killed herself for being bullied. Her parents got together and they started a nonprofit. Angels, I'm going to send it to you. I lost contract. But that right there was touching because we don't first of all, it's hard as a woman anyway. So the She Is movement is not just about bald women. It's about the acceptance. So like I said, I walk in a room. I don't think I'm walking in a room be around other women who have hair and I don't. I don't feel that way. It's you and I can relate. If we sat down and had a long enough conversation, I'm sure there are multiple things that you and I have experienced as women with or without hair, but just as women. So to normalize, and we call it redefining beauty. How I feel that morning, I'm beautiful. How you look in the mirror morning and you feel you're beautiful. And accepting that and kind of being a force against what we see on TV, the beauty
right.
products, the BBLs and all of this. That's cool for some, but not for everybody. Mm-hmm. And to be honest, a man is going to see what's attractive to the eye, yes. But then also, it's about what's in here. So when people say, you know, what do a man, you know, what do they say? They look for what's inside, regardless if you got a big stack in the back or a long weave down your butt. At the end, if he wants something real.
Right.
And a lot of the women, I know our winner, Candy Green, she's from Houston. She actually won the title this year.
Oh, yes. Awesome.
Shout out to Candy Green.
Yes, yes. And she's doing a phenomenal job. And her guy was with her on her journey. And they just had their, what, second year anniversary? I mean, he bald too. And they do their little TikTok things, be dressing all that. I mean, he genuinely loves her. It ain't about the hair. It's what's inside, how you make the man feel, how you comfort him, how you share with him. If you can get to that space, nothing else matters, whether you have hair or not. Because in the winter, when it gets a little cold, depending on if I want to rock my hat or whatever, I might put on my little bob wig. But it's like wearing, for me, a bad pair of shoes. Mm. You can probably get an hour or something out of me. I can't. I'll be in the car and pull that thing. I don't want it. It's an accessory for me now because mm-hmm. I'm in that space. But our organization is for the women who might not be there yet because mental health is real.
Right.
Isolation, suicidal thoughts, because what the world says beautiful is. So imagine she's bald and she might be a little thicker. She's already feeling funny because they think slim or BBL is what's mm-hmm. in, but now you're losing your hair too. If she don't have nobody to talk to, all kind of stuff can happen.
What can you say to that young child who might be going through alopecia or that grown woman who, like what you said, don't know how to tell her husband because she wear a wig all the time and he's never seen her real hair to come out and to be confident about herself? What would you tell them?
If it was a woman and a couple, I believe in therapy big time now because has to be some internal, because you got to find out what's that fear, especially for the person. If he's your husband, anything goes, because if he got sick and you got to wipe his butt, you know, the intimacy is not just the physical, it's everything. So we got to figure out why you fear that, you know, first, and figure that out. And then he has to be open-minded and understand her walk and her journey. And if he loves her, he ain't going nowhere. I've seen people cut their wives' hair. The wife crying and he there holding her compassionately while she's going through that.
Social media
and
too.
It don't always have to be because the person is ill, like how a man would care for his wife mm-hmm. if she had cancer and maybe she's losing hair, but just in general to keep it solid. And that's what it should be. And we're trying to really fight hard to normalize it. That's why we call it a movement, because the more of us start normalizing the acceptance, not just the bald head, but just the acceptance of who we are individually. The other stuff that the people put out here to try to trick us to buy this or trick us to be a certain way and look a certain way, that don't work.
Well, mm-hmm. man, thank you so much. I've learned a lot today, you know. but I will say, you know, even if you can get to a therapist, dope. But make sure you read the Word of God, too. I got to say that because the Holy Spirit is real. And to be honest with you, when you can't get to nobody else, God will come and will touch
there.
Your heart.
Absolutely.
And to be honest with you, the scripture tells you the same thing that you just said about the heart. You know, the man, he definitely looks at the exterior.
Absolutely.
You know, he's definitely looking at your butt. And he's definitely looking at your tits. And he's definitely looking at them women if mm-hmm. they're in bathing suits.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But as you said, if he's serious about her,
if he's looking for
something real and he's going to be with her, he definitely got to tag into that heart. You
Absolutely.
Know what I mean? And they
Absolutely.
Definitely need to be praying together the way I believe. You know
yeah.
what I mean? But at the end of the day, man, you're a strong woman, as I continue to say, you know, to be, you know, able to go through all the stuff that you've been through. I've heard so many things today. I heard that your mother had you as a teen. Then you end up having, you know, do you have a daughter?
Yes, I have a daughter.
How old is she?
She's 32.
Okay, was she?
She was not a teenager.
Come on, man. Let's celebrate. There it is.
Generational
curse. There you go. I'm just thinking about what you said during the
yes.
interview, and
mm-hmm.
that's dope. You see what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
A breakthrough, you know, and I just, you know, I can't wait till you get this husband of yours, and you know, you
speak him into
you,
existence.
Yeah, you don't want
to. I'm not looking,
but you don't have to.
Yeah, he gonna
you don't have
up.
To. He'll be around. But at the end of the day, I just know that definitely is a thing, and God is watching over you. You know,
I appreciate
thank
that.
You so much.
Where can someone reach out to you if they want some advice or, you know, inspiration and so forth?
So I would say contact me on IG. You can DM me. It's she_movement22. And DM me, because I am, like I said, a master coach. I focus on business. So nonprofits building is my thing, but business, financial literacy, but also what we call transformation coaching. And that's for that whole journey of changing or pivoting in your life. And then I do have free consultations. So if they go in there, they'll see the link where they can get a free consultation.
Awesome.
Well, so I'll call you back when I do a business portion to
absolutely.
See. Yeah, let you
especially
run down.
The nonprofit.
Yeah,
piece.
Run down through down what they call it, the five. What is it? That 503C
501C
yeah.
Eyes
look at it, yeah. She gonna help some people to get some nonprofit money.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
Is there like a top three individuals that maybe have alopecia that you look up to because you've seen their movement, you've seen what they've done, unapologetically, just you know the way how they move. Would you like to shout out like the three individuals that you just say?
I can't think of three, but you might know three. But
she might.
Yeah, so the ones that I could think of, and it's more than three, it's a total of 16 beautiful women that I met virtually throughout this whole beautiful ball pageant. When I say you would have thought the sisterhood that we've built, and we just met each other the day before the event, that would be who I would choose.
Already, to be honest. Thank you so much, man. One thing I want to say is thank you. We love you.
Thank you.
Yeah,
love
and
you
could
too.
Come back. I'm gonna let you come back.
Okay, I love
you. Maybe I'll think about it. I don't know.
Is there
you come back
we
on here
out?
Trying to chop me? I will be ready because I'm practicing.
She got you. I ain't got to worry about that. She got you.
Is there anything
thank
we left
you.
Out?
No, we ain't leaving
nothing
out.
I think we're good. Again, we can be contacted on social media. We also have a Facebook page. It's the Bald and Beautiful pageant. So that's where where everything about the pageant is on there. We're going to be doing the casting call releases. We'll be in Chicago, Maryland, Georgia. I'm missing one. California, and then, of course, Texas.
Wow. Congratulations.
So that's going to be our little casting call.
Congratulations,
thank you
man.
Thank
you killed the game,
too.
Man. And tell your son, I say, what's up?
I
you know?
Will.
And tell him
I
to
will.
Keep watching Boss Talk 101, what a boss is talking.
And Jada, yes. You need to get on top of this because this movement is amazing. You need to get with them.
Boss Talk 101.
Thank you, guys.
We out.